Welcome to day 161, Making Songbringer. Man, I'm freaking pumped to have this art pretty much done. So that's what it looks like in the art here in Photoshop. And then when it gets exported into the game, it looks like this with all the dynamic lighting. So today I'm going to be working on fixing a couple potential, one potential bug and one existing bug I know of that's with this soul system here. This is what it looks like now. I'm actually very proud. It finally came out how I wanted it to, what I was imagining. I really love how everything turned out. So yeah, I'm very excited about this. There's one more visual thing I want to do too, and that's to do custom lights. There's right now, there's just a circular light coming off of these hexagonal shaped like lava lamps sort of right there. So I'm going to do some sort of like light that looks like it's shining hexagonally out of those. But then yeah, first I'm going to fix up these two little bugs. And then if there's time, I'm going to be working on teleportation so you can teleport using the teleport cubes back to Songbringer. And that's going to kind of complete the loop of being able to go to Songbringer and come back. All right, so I'm gonna write a little code to make sure it's guaranteed that we don't skip over any phases. So for example, if I set this phase to be zero long, it should skip right the heck over it. Let's see. Set a breakpoint here. And what should happen is it should skip over this. I don't want it to skip over any specific phase because there's some of the phases that are very important. For example, when it creates a new item. Yo, what's up on the Real Red? Yes, good. Okay, so since we ran that and it did not stop there, so that's indicating that it should have stopped there. If the code were written ultimately awesome, it would do that. Yo, man. Yo. What's up, Ethan? Okay, so here's how the code's gonna go to not skip it over. I've already got this vector or a map actually of bools for each subphase. It marks whether it's actually initialized that phase, where it's run it at least once. So I can use that to make sure and not skip over any phases. So for like, we'll go int s equals zero, something like that. Hey, cool, Azarus. Thanks, man. Awesome. No vectors. I'm using a map. Azimuth, I got to get your name and email to get you I've got your email. Never mind. I got your email. It should have come through if you pre-ordered on Humble. But I'll need to get your name that you want credited on the So yeah, why not? Why not right now? What do you want accredited for on the main menu? What name do you want credited? All right, so we're gonna loop over all of the things, all the subphases that have already been initialized. All right, and we can go if subphase is greater than pair.first and not pair.second. Then we've skipped over one, probably. Cool, thanks, Ethan. Yeah, you can pre-order it, man. You just go to songbringer.com. It's on Humble Bundle, so you can. And not only do you get, not only are you pre-ordering it, but you get your name listed in the credits, Ethan. So here's that link, man. And if you don't have money, I totally understand. You don't have to pre-order it, man. You can also use Steam credits once it comes out. What's up, Betavel? Okay, so this is gonna go S plus plus. Yo, Mars of Power, what's up, True Sandwich? Nice, right on. Mars of Power, I just placed your order for your poster. So it's on its way. Well, it's being printed now. It'll probably take a week to print for them to get it through their queue, and then it'll ship out to you. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, it's not. That's what I'm asking you. What name do you want to use? Because all I have right now is your email. So I've got you on the list. You'll get your pre-ordered game. But what name do you want credited on the main menu? Do you want it to be Azenris, or do you have a certain name? You can also email me that if you don't want to. If you don't want to mention it on the stream, I understand. You can always email me. My email is nat@wizardfoo. nat@wizardfoo.com. Ethan, it's $16. 16 American dollars, so yeah. I'm working on, so here, let me show you guys what, this is the art for the Droidsmith. It's all done, just about. I'm going to actually do some special lighting for the lava lamps, but this is what it looks like. This is the final art, basically. So I'm working on this today to just finish up two little things. One thing is that the code is written so that it might actually skip over a subphase of this whole mechanical animation thing. And the other thing is that you can actually not pick up the item and walk out the door, and then you'll never be able to get that item again. So I gotta fix that bug too. So I'm just fixing up a few things here, and then I'm gonna work on teleportation so you actually can use your teleport cubes to come back to Songbringer, and then once you're done, you teleport back to the place that you were at in the overworld. It's roughly the same, Ethan. Oh, Azenris. Okay, cool. I got you, man. I will, let me write down a note to add that later. There. Save this on the desktop. Credit Azenris. So I got this little, this little backers list. It's got everybody's backers' names and everything. And I'll put you on this list later on. But I wrote a note, so I made sure I put it into my spreadsheet as well. Nice. This is for your game, man? Oh, nice. What is this? Is this for Windows or Mac?
Hello, I am Sirsa. I'm the one who made this. Now, what is this? Do I even dare label it as something without making people angry? Ever since my birth, I've grown up as a bit of a doof.
Well, cool, this looks funny. I gotta check this out later on. So it's for Windows, huh? I don't know if it has tax. I don't think it has taxes. You can go on there on the Humble Bundle. You can order with PayPal, so, or your credit card or whatever. So yeah, I don't think it has taxes. Ah, cool, right on. Okay, so I'm doing this thing where it doesn't skip over a phase. Like, it guarantees that it runs a phase, even if the phase has 0 seconds and it doesn't actually compute any alpha for that phase. Yeah, it's looking good, man. Okay, so if the subphase that we're on now, for example, is 1, and the paired out first is, say, 0, the very first phase, and it hasn't initialized that phase, then we need to set the subphase to that. Yeah, so subphase equals 0. And the next thing is to make sure the alpha is back down at 0 as well. And then break. So if this were, say, the next phase, if it were subphase, let's say we had run the first phase 0 and it was now at subphase 1. So if subphase 1 is greater than 1, so it wouldn't do that one. Okay, so let's say if we're at subphase 2 and it hadn't initialized the first one, then it would be subphase 2. First one would be 1, and it hadn't initialized it, then subphase equals s, not 0. There. Cool. All right, so this is where we're guaranteeing that we don't skip over a phase, a subphase. Let's see if this works. So it should hit this breakpoint now. Yes, yeah, that means open, that means close of a block in C++. Okay, so yeah, when I run this, it should now break there. All right, it didn't break. So what happened? Why didn't it break? Let's set a breakpoint here. We'll figure out why it's not doing that. Components, no. Components are new and delete, so they get they get nude and they get deleted when they're done. But entities, yes, there's entities are all technically integers. So yeah, all the integers are reused. So for example, you can have on one scene you can have integers 1 through 100 or entities 1 through 100, and then the next scene you go to they're like 100 through 200. And then when you go back to the third scene, it'll use 1 through 100 again. So yeah. And that's all in entity foo. Yes, it would be very good for performance if I did reuse components. But that's especially because of sprites. In CocoStudiX, when you initialize a new sprite, it loads stuff and does all its allocation and stuff. It's actually a pretty expensive operation to create a new sprite. So if I were to reuse render components, that would be the ultimate. That would be a big improvement, I think, on the performance when you're switching from area to area, at least in this game engine. Yeah, that's a good question. What's up, Kaz the Gamer? Ethan, no, if you pre-order Songbringer, you get the game when it comes out. That's going to be either January, February, or March. For you to get the alpha, you have to pre-order at the $64, or actually the 100. I'm not exactly sure yet. But you have to pre-order at a higher level. So, oh, true sandwich. That's a really, really complicated answer to give you there for that. I can't really, it would take me days to tell you how to do that, really. But basically, you have to just, if you want people to create their own servers, you just have to code it that way. I mean, that's a really complex thing. I can't really, that's hard for me to answer, man. Sorry. Yeah, but I've done this before. This is a very, very, very complicated thing. But you can do it. If you create and locate the same sprite? Yes, yeah, Mars Power, yeah. Even if you create the exact same sprite, it's not that it has to load the sprite's data. It's that it has to allocate data for the sprite, run all this initialization, set up the GL stuff. So it's a lot faster if you've already created all these sprites and you just simply switch their current frame when you're reusing the component. Kaz the Gamer, yeah, it's coming out on Windows, Mac, and Linux the first quarter of 2016. And then it's also going to come out on iOS a few months after that. And if they get enough pre-orders for it, it'll come out on Android, PlayStation 4, and Xbox, and also maybe even Retro VGS if the talks go well with those guys. Yep, yeah, you'll have to wait a million months. Okay, so all right, good. We got the breakpoint here. It should be subphase one. Yes, okay, we're at subphase one. The alpha is zero. That's okay. So yeah, it split the alpha zero into a subphase of one. That's good. That's what was expected. But why isn't this guaranteed code working? What? Oh, there's nothing in initialized yet. Okay. So we need to push back everything. So initialize integer is well, we'll just do a count. There, so that'll set them all to false. They've not been initialized. That's probably what it was. Yes, yeah, there is. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So to make the process a lot faster, what you would do is create only one sprite and you reuse it by using set sprite frame. Let me show you that. I'll just look for set sprite frame somewhere in my code. I use this like all the time. So yeah, you just reuse your sprite somehow. And if you're using an editing component system, you'd reuse your render component or something. But then you just call this set sprite frame. So every sprite has a set sprite frame method, and you can change the current frame that it's at. So that's what you would do. You reuse the same sprite, just change its current frame, and that's it. But you'd also need to make sure that you might have to set the texture. So if you're changing the sprite sheet as well, you would need to call set texture, which would be like, it's set texture. So then you can either use a file name, the actual texture pointer, or whatever. Is that answering that question for you, man? Yeah, Ethan, this is to make a randomly seeded game, is also another really complex answer to give you. And yes, there are videos on that. But essentially what you do is you have a seed, whatever that seed is, and then you use a deterministic random number generator to make sure your random numbers are always the same, no matter what platform you're on. And then you generate your world or your game based on that number. That's all there is to it. But it's a lot more complicated than that in practice because of, creating a game that's based on a random number. What's up, June Dury? Cool, man. Right on. Yeah, well, I'm continuing right into the same stuff then. Not very nice, man. Hey, what's up, Steve Tramby? Yo. Okay, so this should now break. Now we fixed those initialized. I++, yeah. So what this is doing is guaranteeing that it will hit this subphase no matter what. Creeper, what's up? Okay, so the question is, I need multiple instances of the same sprite at the same time. I can use a single pool of reusable sprites and just update their frame. Yes. Yes. Totally. Creeper. Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. Yeah, still got tendonitis, but it's getting better. It's getting a lot better every day. It was like almost healed a few months ago, and then I started doing a bunch of like too much yoga, and kind of hurt it again. So I need to lay off doing certain yoga moves. Okay, so here we are. S is zero. Subphase is one. If subphase is greater than pair dot first, which would be zero. Let's look at pair. Yeah, zero. And not pair dot second, subphase equals should be S is zero. Yes. A equals zero. Yeah. Break. Subphase zero. Boom. All right, cool. Let's turn off this breakpoint, and now we can prove it by running it again, and it should hit that breakpoint. Yeah, cool, man. Yeah, try it out. Yeah, it'll work, man. Optimization day, cool. I love those days. I love it when your game just gets so much faster. Yeah, right. So it hit phase zero. Even though phase zero was 0 seconds long, which this could happen in, let's say your game, all of a sudden your processor goes crazy or something like that. Your game takes a long time. It might take a while to get to the next phase, and this is just going to guarantee that it never ever skips over a phase. So good. That's a really good improvement. Now, what was that? Oh, yeah. So now I can go back to this where this phase was 1.4 seconds. There we go. Okay, good. Now the next thing I want to do this thing. Watch this. If I go and craft an item. Cool. Nice, Trammy. Nice. Thank you, man. Thank you. That's really good to know I'm on the right track because I agree. I like the art a lot better. And yeah, I really love how this Smith moves, and I like his sounds too. It just makes me, he's like working for his he's working for his paycheck here, man. He's doing stuff. So here's the bug. If I leave this room right now, I've lost both those items, and when I come back into this room, I'm not gonna, it's not gonna have that fire orb. So the next goal is to fix that, and then I'll visually fix it up. Yeah, it's looking a lot better, right? I mean, this has taken like freaking 5 days to do just this one little scene. I think 5 days, right? This is Monday, Sunday, Saturday, Friday, Thursday. I think about 5 days of doing this, but I think it's worth it. And besides, now that I've gotten this scene sort of looking good, this is somewhat like the rest of the inside of Songbringer. So as I do the other five scenes for the inside of Songbringer, it's going to be a lot quicker to do those ones, especially because this one to adds so many moving parts, you know what I mean? So much of a huge scene going on. Yeah, right, reverse steal. Hey, what's up, Mr. Tim? Yo, man. Yeah, it's been a while. Remember we were chatting about something hardware related a long time ago. Welcome back, man. Okay, so yeah, we're gonna guarantee that the player can recraft an item if they leave without picking up this new item. So, how am I gonna do that? Set your initial spawn in the Droidsmith Cavern? Oh. Yeah, so like if I want to put the player in a certain place, I just set the settings for the game. Here's all the settings for the game. One of them is like the player's position. I just set that. And that puts me right into this room, so it spawns me there every time. Is that what you're asking, Overseer? Nice, right on. Okay, so let's get this to not be able to. Oh yeah, so this would go here's where it just a few more subphases down. It actually creates the item. Here it is, where it creates the new item. Removes the existing items. But we don't want to take away their crafting. Okay, so here's, I'm gonna write down a little bit of notes here because I don't want to get distracted for doing these because I know there's some specific things needing to go. So one, when the when player picks up crafted item, clear crafting. Secondly, what's the other? There's two more things that need to happen here. That might be it. That's. No, I guess that might be all. I guess we'll just figure it out as we go. Okay. On. Yeah, it's totally. It's become like a total community. Everybody's stoked about the game, and since you visited, there's been a Kickstarter. And the Kickstarter went really well. I got enough funds to actually continue doing this full time. So before I was doing this full time, and now I can continue doing it full time. So that's awesome. Oh, Marza, no. It's actually, well, it depends on the platform. But on Mac, it actually uses defaults. It's this thing called defaults. It's actually a command, and it saves it in a property list somewhere. I actually have no idea where it saves it. But on Windows, it actually uses an XML file. Oh, Azimers, yeah, I already fixed that. I already fixed that. Yeah. Okay, so let's do this. So it's not gonna remove these items from your crafting until you pick up the new item. So system, item system. Well, no, let's go gear system. I think it's gear system pickup item. Here it is, pickup item. So all right, here it is. So this is where we're going to clear crafting once picked up new item. So this is if the current area, have I gotten that? World area. Area. Let's grab area at the very top of this method. Right. And then we'll just remove, we'll change everything that's world area to area. Slight performance optimization there too. Yay. Okay, now If the current area is the droid smith, then we're gonna do this. Basically just clears the crafted items, but only once you've gone and picked up the new item. I guess that's all you have to do. Let's see if this works. I probably should. I don't know if I should or not use a. I'm really curious out of how Retro VGS works, because I don't know if I'm gonna have to rewrite this whole game engine for Retro VGS. If they make it really difficult to make games for it, it's gonna be a sucky platform. It doesn't matter whether it's so cool and it looks awesome, but if they don't make it friendly for game developers to make current day games on, it's not gonna be very cool. So I really hope to talk to them soon and figure out what they're doing. If they support OpenGL, then they'll be cool. But if they don't support OpenGL, it's gonna be so hard. It's gonna be a complete rewrite of Cocos 2DX. Okay, so yeah, it's still got those in my inventory, so I can't go. Let's say I try and use the fire cube again. Yeah, see, I can't use those. Oh, I should also make it so. That's what I was thinking. I can't. Oh, good. It's not letting me place another item. Oh, that's the other thing I wanted to do. Okay, so if I leave this room, I should still have the two item pieces that I can use to go recraft that item. Let's try it. I guess it worked. Yeah. Oh, nice. Yeah, Game Overseer for sure. What platform are you on, man? Right, cool. So it's the same thing. Yeah, it's the same thing that now. And I still can't use these items. I don't know why. See if I can craft items now. Yeah, see, it won't let me craft once I've already crafted, I guess. But now it should be good. Like, it's not gonna. Yeah, good. Okay, cool. Okay, yeah, I fixed it. So now you can. There's no way you can lose out on your items. You have to actually. All right, cool. It's fixed. Done. Yeah, you can. Yeah, it's already nope. Mars Power already fixed that. Yeah, why? I'll show you. So you put down the wrong item or whatever. Combo doesn't work like this. I put down the sword and the top hat. There's no way you can combine these. He gets pissed off or whatever. Let's say I go pick up one of them. Let's say I even leave. If I leave the room, it goes and it automatically picks things up. See that? I still have my top hat. But you're saying if I go pick it up and try and do a different combination, it doesn't matter. It all works. I've fixed all the bugs, so. So I put down a top hat and a combo that does work, Blink Orb. See? So you can recoup the items that you dropped. And yeah. And also you can't leave stuff. So if I leave that on the floor, it picks it up automatically. So yeah, that's all good. Hey, Deathstroke, man, it's coming out on Windows, Mac, and Linux on Steam. So that's coming out quarter one of 2016. So like January, February, March, and you can pre-order it right now. Pre-orders cost $16. You can order it at songwringer.com, and that gets you your name in the credits and on the main menu. Types of enemies? There's probably going to be, I don't know, 30 types of enemies, something like that, and then 9 different bosses. Yeah, Creeper, I mean, yeah, I could do that. I could go the extra step and make him actually pick it up, but I'm already over this. Dude, I worked on this 5 days, and I think it's a good enough thing. You know what I mean? If a player, I mean, who's actually going to do that? You know what I mean? If a person is so not mindful enough that they're actually going to leave an item on the ground that's a valuable thing, then they're probably not going to be mindful enough to pay attention to the fact that you don't actually pick it up. And secondly, the screen is fading to black right there. And when you fade to black, technically anything could be happening at that point. So I think it's okay. I'm just not going to keep on working on it right now. Yeah, but those are just chipsets, you know, and like processor type things. They haven't said anything about whether they support OpenGL. So that's what I'm really, really wondering. I hope it works. Yeah, I mean, it would be cool, but it's going to take so much more time to do that already. So I'm going to keep on not doing it right now. Okay, so the next plan I want to do is to do some better lights for these plasma orbs or plasma lamp thingies. I want them to actually shine some light out. So they're actually going to like have like blurry light coming out of their sides. So I want to do the width of this thing a lot wider, maybe even 128, something like that. Let's grab this green color as a background. All right, cool. Yeah, I know. I'm trying to stay interested. I do want to talk to those guys. I want to talk. The main guy, Mike Kennedy, actually wrote me back on email, and he said let's talk. But then he never wrote me back again, so I haven't heard from him. But he was at E3, so he might have just been really busy. So I'm gonna give him another email and try and reach out and figure out, you know, the software end of things. It sounds like they're building a really awesome hardware. You know what I mean? RetroVGS sounds like a great piece of hardware. But are they going to support the software where it's going to be friendly enough that indies that are using OpenGL or anything that's based on OpenGL can use it? You know what I mean? Yeah, that's what happens. It gets put back in your inventory, but it's not on the floor anymore. Yeah, I don't know. Deathstroke, yo, you gotta do what's called green light. It's called Steam green light. Let me look up. I'll give you some good instructions on how to do that. I did this one article on it. Here it is. It's from GameDevelopment.tutsplus. Here you go, Deathstroke. There's your link, man. All right, Marza, good night, man. Oh, what? The final product? Oh, no, I guess like, yo, if the player leaves the room without picking up the final product, yeah, I guess I could make it so that it goes right in their inventory, but I'd rather just make it so that it puts the items that they had crafted back in their inventory. I guess you're right. It doesn't make as much sense that it works that way, but, you know, this is a really, really edge case, you know what I mean? I think there's going to be very few people that go through the process of crafting an item. They have to randomly try and find items to craft, and they get this successful thing, and it puts down the new item, who's going to forget to go pick up that item? And, you know, if they are, then it's the game is gracious enough to give them back the two items they used to combine it. So I'm pretty sure this situation is okay enough for now. All right, so this is about the light color, this orange light here. And I want to do some light shining out the sides at a nice angle. And I did these new brushes so I can do angles really quick. This is cool. So I'll do it on a layer below everything else so I can like get this going on. Oops. There. Right, yeah, Overseer. And essentially, Mars Power, that is, I guess, the way you would cancel the process. If you want to cancel the process, let's say you've already started the crafting process and you leave the room, then that technically is canceling it. You still have the two items you use. That's a good point, Overseer. Yeah. I know what you mean. I know what you mean. Yeah, I probably shouldn't be estimating that it's such an edge case. It probably will be something that happens a lot. But at least it's good enough that they're not going to lose out. So, yeah, cool. Nice. Okay, all right, so let's get this light over here on. All right, so now I'm gonna do sort of a circle. Yeah, actually a circle. Let's do a new layer below it. This is actually gonna be too much. So. About six of those little double lines there. I'm deleting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There. So now I can go a layer below, do a big circle, and then cut it in half to do like a. Let's measure this. How big is that? 49 pixels tall. So I can do actually a 49 pixel tall brush. Look at that. It's 50. It was pretty close. Yay, cool. So we'll do like that. All right, so let's hide the rest of this stuff. Figure out why that's not working. Oh, right on. Good, Azarus. Yeah, man, I'm glad, dude. Good for you, man. I know, a while ago you were kind of getting frustrated with pixel art and stuff like that, so I really think a graphics tablet will help, but at first I will tell you that a graphics tablet itself will be kind of a frustrating thing. So once you get it, the thing you got to get used to is how to actually use it, you know? Like you with this graphics tablet, you actually you don't even touch the tablet to move your cursor, and then when you want to touch something, you tap it. So getting used to this is just to spend time just getting used to this. You know what I mean? Just plan that. Plan an entire week where you're just getting your muscle memory used to this, moving your cursor all around. And it's absolute too, so you can put your pen in the top right, and it's up here. Pen to the bottom left, it's down here. So it takes some time. I actually spent an entire year not using my pen before I ever even picked it up. What's up, Nostrobot? All right, I think I'm gonna shorten this. This is like a bit too much here. Let's go 50% on that width. Okay, so approximately that's about right. Let's make sure that's not propagate frame one. Scourge. Bad propagate frame one. Now I want a lava lamp again. Yeah, it's totally straightforward, but it does take time. Okay, so now I'm gonna blur this. Give it some actual light feeling. Well, before I do that, I'm gonna duplicate this layer just in case I wanna use it again. And I also wanna make sure this image mode is now in 16 bits a channel. And that's gonna create a really nice blur. I wish that Photoshop would allow you to do 32 bits a channel in regular documents, but once you go into 32 bits a channel, it gets into this weird mode and it doesn't like, it's just not as friendly to use. Okay, so we do need more width. Let's do 164 pixels wide. Yeah, the Gaussian, right? It's my go-to blur. There it is. Okay, and actually we're going to save this as a different file. Lava lamp blur. Because this needs to be additive lighting. And stuff. Okay, so getting about, well, I guess we don't even need to worry about its opacity. Yeah, okay, that's all right. So I can turn on this green background for every one of them to make sure this layer here is all good. So we're going up a pixel here. Okay, now let's see if that's actually working. Yeah, that's what I wanted. Okay, so now it's following, this light is now following the lava lamp in its floatiness. Okay, now I can go and turn off everything else that's not needed. There we go. All right, export this. Render video. Sheets, ship, lava lamp, blur. Cool. All right, so now I can use this blur when we're creating the this lava lamp tile's glow sprite. So the glow sprite is here. Wait, did I call it lava lamp blur? Yeah, lava lamp blur. Zero. Let's make sure the files got exported. Yep, lava lamp blur, 0 through 6. It's 7 frames. This ought to be okay here. Oh, we need to make sure that it's half the height. Or just get anchored at 0. More simple. Okay, now we're gonna load the anim auto ref anim equals kit anim lava lamp blur percent d dot ping. Instead of this, we're gonna do an actual. Run action, repeat forever, create, animate, create, and then there. Should do that. Hey, what's up, Teek? Okay, so that should. If that works, then we'll have a nice sort of glow coming off of these lava lamps. It also follows the floaty part of the lamps. Okay, we also need to set the delay per frame, delay per unit, quarter second for those. And why are they at 0? Or maybe they need to be -1/2. Oh, +1/2, I guess. Oh, that's oil. Yeah, that's an oil spill. It's got a little, it's a little oil can or oil. Like I was imagining like, you know, some oil you'd get for your car or whatever. And just it tipped over and spilled some oil on the ground. Yeah. That was a suggestion from somebody on the stream. He's like, why don't you draw some oil? I'm like, cool. That's simple. I can do it right now. It's easy. So one thing is that it says this delay before, so I guess we can just stop this delay, and I think that should sync them up. We need to put this in its own again. Yeah, you're item crafting, Teek. Yeah, so you take two items and you craft them into a second one. Yeah, it's not infinite crafting though. It's actually limited crafting, but as a player you get to experiment and try different combinations of items. Yeah, look at that. It worked. That looks pretty good. Okay, so next thing, I want to change it so it's colored in the code. All right, so desaturate all these. Hue, saturation all the way down. And we can make sure it's applied for every one of these layers and it's not propagate frame one. There, so cool. Now this could be procedurally colored if desired. So we'll set the color here in the frame in the this to the light color. So glow. Set color, light color. Set its opacity a little farther down too. It was a little bit high, so let's try it at half to start with. 90s rock band posters. Oh, good idea. I'm gonna draw one of those right now. Yeah, right after I finish this lava lamp, I'm drawing a rock band poster on the back. It doesn't even look like they're moving with it now. So let's actually set it higher. That was like kind of cool with this opacity really high. That's a good one too. Yeah. And leopard carpet. What's up, Platformer Labs? Yeah, that works. Okay, so now it's at 200 opacity rather than two, like 250. So it's giving it a nice glow. I love it. Okay, rock band poster. What's up, baby? I know, right? I'm streaming.
Oh, hi. Sorry.
I know. I was like, the guy laughed at me this morning. He's all, "Hey, nice car, man." We had to pick up a friend's minivan this morning. It was funny. I'm like, I'm driving a minivan right now.
Just closing this.
Oh, I thought you said so. Thanks, baby. Right, so rock band poster. I'm gonna draw it first on the wall behind here, and then I'll skew it and put it right here. Yeah, I know, I gotta work on the teleport cubes today too. How much time do I have left? I still have an hour, so yeah, I can. There's enough time to draw a rock band poster and then start working on the teleport cubes. Oh man. Teleport Cubes is the band name. All right, so we'll turn off this apparatus. All right, I'm thinking I kind of want to make it white as a background. Bringer of songs. Obviously, we're not going to be able to write any of those and actually have it visible here. Because it's too little pixels, but I'm going to try and get like a guy. Right? The bringers? Always start with the, yeah. Yeah, scribbles were basically gonna have to be the words. Should he have a lighter in his hand or something? It's cute, like a silver color for his lighter. That didn't work. Maybe this needs to be like this. Man, it's hard to draw a lighter that small. I guess his arm's too high anyways. Nice. Ah. Oh, skull, yeah. Middle finger, that's kind of what it is, right? That's what it looks like. I think it needs to go like that. Let's do like another. I wonder if it would look like cool like that. I don't know if the effect is really visible. Yeah, that's cool enough. Music notes, huh? Yeah, you think the paper's too white? Probably, yeah, it is. Yeah, and a good way to show that is to turn on... Actually, I should do this for this whole document. This is a really important thing to do where you... To like do a saturation layer where it desaturates everything. Turn everything to grayscale, basically. And then you can see whether things are, you know, whether you've still got the right tones for stuff. Yeah, that's what I was thinking, to pop the collar, but I don't know if it looked that good. Yeah, see, now it's a lot better. And you can kind of distinguish. I guess it could go a little darker in its tone. Yeah, that's better. But it would be fun if it had a color, too. Or not. I don't know. Yeah, good idea. That's pretty cool. All right. You know what? I think I would like to do a. Let's put some like grease and stuff onto it by doing some shading. So I'm gonna do just some real nice light shading. Yes, totally. He's a fan. So yeah, the Droidsmith is the fan here. The Droidsmith is a fan of this band. So he has like an emotional unit or something. So what I'm going to do for shading is I'm just going to use like a very, very low opacity pencil. It's not working. What's up? Okay, that's weird. 2%, come on. Oh, now it's working. That's good enough. Now it kind of looks more human and more dirty and stuff. What's up, Achillium? Okay, so I was thinking that it would go actually on the other wall here. Let's see if that makes sense to kind of bend this all and put it on another wall. Because if this is in the way, the apparatus... Oh, actually, you can kind of see it. Let's try that. Let's try it right now without bending it too much. Oh, I forgot a couple things. There's the glow shadow. Yep. And then this other one, that's only for a certain kind of, yeah. Okay, let's see what this looks like. Yeah, it's looking good. Not bad. Once it gets in the game, it just all of a sudden it looks like 10 times better with the lighting. I kind of like it out back there. I do want to try it actually on the wall. On the other wall too, to see if it might look a little better. So I'm gonna merge these into one poster layer. Call this poster. And then I'm gonna duplicate it. Hide the first one. I'm gonna move this over to this wall and mess with all the pixels to give it a staggered look. So two pixels at a time. Just gonna move it up. There we go. Okay, let's see what this looks like. Yeah. Oh, peeling down one? Yeah. Yeah, no, I didn't rewrite the light shader at all. This is just a room with different lighting. I think it looks so good because there's these light beams coming in too. You see on the tops? And those are Those are new. So that's probably what it is you're seeing is the light beams. So you see what happened is as you actually get to this angle, it would have squished the poster in together a little bit. Oh man, but I gotta do it. I gotta try taking out at least a pixel. I'm thinking this pixel. No, that's a bad one to remove. Maybe this pixel. Then. Maybe this pixel here. Now to get them lined up how they should be now, that should be there. Okay, let's see if that looks about right. Yeah, see, that's a lot better. Just taking out two pixels made it so it looks right in that. Yeah, I know what you mean, peeling, yeah. Yeah, totally, right? That's what I kind of meant for this whole room to look like it was the inside of something. So this big laser has sort of like this tons of space around it to do stuff. And then the rest of Songbringer, the ship, is going to have Lots and lots of open space as well, because it's meant to have an open air park inside it. So it's got like all this moss on the walls. This is like moss, which produces oxygen and processes the carbon dioxide and all the oxygen and all that. Carbon dioxide, not oxygen. Okay, let's see what that looks like with the poster on that wall. Yeah, I love it. I love it with the poster like that. Sick. Okay, let's do one more poster on the other wall. And we'll do a different, totally different image for this one. All right. We didn't use too much time doing that, did we? Yeah, that was only 15 minutes. Only 15 minutes. Okay, so what to do for this one? What's up, Professional Novice? Thanks, June Dewey. A Moon with Some Wolves? Like, what was that band? What was that? What album cover is that? Oh, that'd be cool. Yeah. Maybe it's a band of robots or something that this guy likes. Well, I mean, I guess he can like any kind of music he wants. How about a wolf howling at the moon? Is that what you're saying? Yeah, you said wolves. All right, cool. We're doing it. Wolves, moon, done. All right. Moon. Gotta get this midnight bluish. Do white. Nice, right on, man. Yeah, the game's coming great. I'm working on this item crafting guy where you bring this guy two items and he crafts you a third one. Oh yeah? Oh okay, I guess we're thinking of the same thing, but I thought there was an album that had that same type of design on it. Thanks, Thomas. Yeah, right? I wouldn't be surprised either. hard to draw a wolf so small. But is that look like a wolf, kind of? What's that? Let's look at the wolves howling at the moon poster and see. Right? A Zelda poster? This is fun because I can do this for all. There's going to be five more rooms of Songbringer. So yeah, this is Six Pixel Wolf, man. It's a band itself. Oh, this is what I was thinking here. So it's more of an angle. Okay, so I can get a few more pixels in there. Nice, thanks, Teek. So if I get some more ground here for him to stand on. And like he kind of has legs. I think that kind of works. See if we could have a tail as well. Oh yeah, that's it. That did it. Nice. How many pixels is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 12 pixel wolf, man. Yes, yeah, they are. Including the robots. Including the robots. All right, now for some shading. Shading. New layer, and I do this thing to make it go on that layer. And I get a black. And I set my pencil to like 2% opacity. Now we can like make some squares and circles in the moon a little bit. And we'll like shade up this this cliff or whatever this is here a little bit. It's just the 2% opacity thing. Opacity pencil is just really easy to do shading that way. Nice and gradual. That's where the robot dance move came. Definitely 70s too. Yeah, my favorite era. Late 60s, early 70s. Yeah. Oh, there's gonna be a whole. So one of the actual rooms that you go to on Songbringer is the dance floor, where you actually once you get your guitar, you actually go there with Jib, and Jib plays beats, and you play the guitar, and that's gonna be one scene, and also you can go there when you don't have your guitar, and there'll be other DJs playing, and there'll be lots of people there dancing, so it's like a constant dance party at this place. Okay, that's good enough. Let's rough it up and then peel it down. I know, right? The Nirvana face? Yeah. Man, there's going to be so many posters on this ship. Okay, so I'm going to peel down this edge right back here. I'm going to use a dark, like, gray color. for the background. Yeah, it's the poster bringer. It just shoots posters at people. They fly to every planet and they just barrage it with posters. Is that enough? That'll do. Okay, same thing. I'm going to actually shade that a little too. It's the funniest idea ever, putting posters on here. Thanks, Creeper. There you go. Yeah. You have to walk the plank and then you get turned into a poster. Well, everybody remembers. It almost gives it like a dance floor style feeling. Like as if that's some kind of, that little circular thing in the middle is some stage. All right, so let's see this all do, let's see this one more time in action. And then we'll do the teleporting. Sweet. I like it. I like it a lot. Yeah, he talks. Yeah, he actually talks. See him when he approves and he disapproves, he talks exactly like Jib does. So they both talk in sort of a robotic language that we as an audience cannot understand, but Rock, the main hero, can understand. Except for he can, what's funny is he can understand Jib, but he can't understand the droid Smith. So what's actually going to happen here is that Jib is going to translate for you. So once I get the dialogue going, the droid Smith will go burr, 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 and say stuff, and then Jib will translate, and then your character will go, oh, I see, blah, 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 Jib. And so as an audience, we don't know what the heck Jib or the droid Smith ever says. But Rock does understand Jib. So that's going to be fun, put dialogue in. I agree. These shouldn't be perfectly centered. Because these are kind of like, you know, dirty posters. Might even... Yeah, that's good. Whoops. How much dialogue? Man, I don't know. I haven't done any estimates on that. I guess not that much. You know, there's really only like maybe 5 to 10 cutscenes where there's going to be dialogue, and maybe, you know, at most like maybe 10 lines of dialogue per. So I guess maybe maximum 100 lines of dialogue, something like that. And it's all just text based, so that's easy enough to just edit the text. Yeah, well, yeah, in some senses I want to tell the player what to do, and most of the time I don't. This is meant to be an adventure game in the sense where you're supposed to get the feeling of accomplishment from figuring out how the heck things work. So in some ways I do want to help hold the player's hand, but in other ways I'm going to keep it old school and keep it 8-bit in the sense that you got to figure it out or read the manual. And the manual in this sense is going to be the internet, where other people have already figured it out. So yeah, not too much. Yeah. Okay, good enough, man. I'm calling this good. We're going to go move on to doing teleportation. Teleportation, you're going to need to teleport cubes. So let's draw some teleport cubes really quick. And then we'll start doing the mechanics for it. So we can, once we got the teleport cubes, we can, let's create the teleport cubes item first. Okay. Item. All right. All right, so it's just called teleport. Now I'll go actually create an item for it. No, you can't actually fall off the edge in this scene. No. But I'm thinking in the rest of the game you will. So I had originally imagined to put railings on the sides of things on the Songbringer ship, but I guess I haven't put railings yet. I don't know whether I will or not, whether you just, you know, you just automatically don't walk off the edge. Or, I mean, I guess I could make it. Once I do add falling to the rest of the game, maybe I will. Magnetic boots. That'd be a cool item, actually. All right, here we go. Teleport. You're going to start the game with this, too. I guess you can have a maximum of one of them. They're not craftable. You can't purchase them, but you can equip them. Okay, so there. Man, it's so much nicer having all of the settings for one item in one place. Makes it so easy to add items now. Yeah, Teak, I already did that. Yep. I have that option already on in the Twitch options. And so you guys should be having the faster chat here. So, hope that works. Yeah, I've had that on for weeks, so we're good to go there. All right, HUD. Where is it? HUD. Huh. Sprites. HUD. What's up, Bodan77? Iron Scissors, sure, man. Yeah, let me show you. Welcome to the stream, by the way. I'll show you the game really quick. And then I'll get back to doing these teleport orbs. Teleport cubes. So it doesn't like this. No item key for item 8. Oh. Did I do the wrong item key for it? Ah, here it is. Teleport. Wow, yeah. I know it was 30 30 before for some people. They were measuring it and stuff back then. So, Iron Scissor, yeah, here's the game, man. So here, this is, you're on, it's like Zelda 1, but it's sci-fi and futuristic. And this is a scene where you're on your ship, Songbringer, and this is where you can craft items and stuff. I'm going to walk out of this room right here, and it's going to put me back on the overworld, but that's not actually what happens in the game. So in the game, you'll actually teleport to back to your ship, Songbringer, and otherwise you're just running around here in the overworld or dungeons. So this is what it's like. It's just like Zelda 1, but you have a nano sword. It's like sci-fi. And then you also got the dungeon. So I'll show you what a dungeon real quick. So there's lots of different items you find. You can combine them as well as craft new items. So some items you can combine. Oh, there's a cactus. Oh, dang. I'll show you the cactus. The cactus is kind of cool because when you eat a cactus, you get to see secrets. So it's like Zelda in the sense where you can bomb walls and find secrets and stuff like that on the overworld as well as in dungeons. And so when you eat cactuses, that shows you secrets. So you get these psychedelic powers. And you can see secret walls. Oh, there's some bug. What the heck happened with these Z orders? Forgot about that. But anyway, this is kind of what the game looks like. What the heck happened with the Z ordering? All of a sudden, again. Thanks, man. Yes, yeah, I make this alone, man. I make the music, I make the art, and I do the code. Wow, that's amazing. 5 seconds. Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I've been doing this for 20 years, so I should be a good coder by now. The place I'm shaky is art. I've only been doing art for a few years, so sometimes I lose confidence or I get creative blocks with making art sometimes. So still learning that. But music I'm pretty solid on as well. I'm pretty confident making music. So, but it just takes time to develop those, you know, you can do all those things too. It just takes time. So I'm going to make them kind of like these, the shape of these bomb cubes. So the way these are going to work is they emit this like energy field that warps you. So it's going to be cool because I'm going to do a render texture type effect, kind of like Fel's telekinesis. Yeah, I highly recommend starting with C++ if anybody is learning. Ah, well, what engine are you, what engine attracts you over here? You have a certain game engine you'd like to use, like Game Maker or Unity or something like that? All right, T, good night, man. So these in the front here are 8x8, and these should be like 6x6. or 7x7. Let's give them the effect that they're right behind the other one. Unity, there you go. Well, game overseer, let's start with Unity. You said you're already there with Unity, so start there. Go find yourself the simplest tutorial you can find on Unity. Like, go find a breakout clone tutorial, or like a Tetris tutorial, or a solitaire tutorial, or something like that. And then just do that. And keep on doing small, simple, easy tutorials until you start getting really comfortable with Unity. And don't worry about coding as much as you do learning the overall process of making games. So don't worry too much about programming. You are going to have to learn some programming, of course, you know, but just let that process go and focus on the overall process of making games. Proton, no, it's a C++ 11 right now because Cocos 2DX has to support many different IDEs. So, for example, Visual Studio has the worst support for, you know, new C++ features. They still haven't even fully supported C++ 11, and it's oh, see, finally they're getting the new ones in VS 2015 here. So here you can always go look up, really, basically, if you want to look up what Cocos 2DX supports, you probably just go look at what Visual C++ supports, and they're only going to use the minimum that supports, because Cocos 2DX has to compile for Mac, Windows, Linux, Android, iOS, BlackBerry, like a whole bunch of different things. And so pretty much Visual C++ is the lagger as far as what they support. So this is kind of where I go to if I want to see where C++ support is at the current point. Yeah, well, they say that, but we'll see if it works, if they all work. Oh, Overseer, don't listen to those kind of people. Yeah, you know, what they're saying is that those people are probably just saying that because they think it's cool that they can develop a game engine, or they prefer to develop game engines and not games. So don't listen to them. Just go use a game engine. Trust me. Use a game engine because it's going to save you years. And I prefer, to this day, I used to write game engines myself, and it takes a long time. And it's very technical, and it's not something you ever need to do. If you want to make games, don't worry about making game engines. Worry about making games, man. I hope that helps you, though. Yeah. Where's my const expression? I know, right, Azenris? I can't believe they still don't support that in 2012 or the 2013 one. Const expression. Yeah, when I first wrote Songbringer, I had const expression used in a few different places. And then when I finally got the Windows build going, I'm like, I can't use const expression? That's the most simple thing in the world. Yeah. Panic. I'm thinking it's because they just want to tout how good they are, you know? Learn to make a game engine because you should be like me. That's my only thought. Yeah, liking good. I'm glad you guys are backing me up on this. This is cool. I'm glad you guys think that too. Especially if you're a beginner. Don't worry about making a game engine if you're a beginner. No, Overseer, they don't all have watermarks. Yeah, maybe that too. Maybe they're just dicks and they want to make people give up. That's stupid. I don't like that at all. But yeah, that could be. Oh, all right. Cool. Good thought, Caviar. I'll do that right now. Hit panels. All right, this should be updated. Yeah, there you go. Yes, good example, Serious Creeper, right? I want to learn to drive. Well, you should learn how to build your own car from scratch and weld everything yourself. That's exactly what people are saying when they're saying, "Hey, like, get started in game development, make your own game engine." Pfft. Yeah, you can definitely use GCC on Windows. Oh, that's a good point, Bodan. I think maybe you could actually compile. I don't know whether you can compile. You probably can. Because, I mean, they've got it set up so you can do Linux building, and Linux is using GCC, I believe. So even if they don't support it, I'm sure they wouldn't. It would only be a couple steps away from being supported that way. It's a good question. Okay, I'm just going to export these as they are right now. I mean, these are not finished at all artistically, but I'd really like to try and get some of this coding mechanics done for the teleport so you can actually get back to Songbringer's ship from the overworld today, right now on the stream. Let's see how much time we have. Sorry, guys, I'm kind of sleepy today. Sleepy, lazy. All right, so this is going to be its own layer. So I'll go layer, new layer base slice. Name this one teleport cubes. Export this. Really? Q2? Go. I thought people would have figured out Q1 if I had put it in parentheses. But I guess. All right. Twitch, Wizard Foo. All right, Q2. Come on, why is my mouse working? There we go. Plans are released Q1, it's January, February, March, iOS, be Q2, April, May, or June. There. Done! Oh, yeah, I know what you mean. Totally know what you mean. Uh-huh. Oh, Oh, really? The Kappa smiley is ironic? Oh, I never knew that. Oh, thanks, Nostrobot. Oh, I never knew that. Yeah, see, now I learned something totally new. The Kappa is ironic smiley. Okay. I'm trying to remember this. Kappa equals ironic smiley. I got to put it in programmer thought. Game overseer, man. A compiler is something... Don't worry about what a compiler is or whether you need to use more than one software for developing right now. You said you like Unity. Start with Unity. Unity essentially is your compiler. What a compiler is really is it just takes your source code files and compiles them into an executable file, which basically just takes your source code language and puts it in machine language that a processor can run. But you don't even need to worry about that with Unity. You don't even need to do that. Think about that at all. And the same thing, no, you don't need to use more than one software for developing. All you need is Unity and some software to make art, like Photoshop, and some software to make music, like Ableton or whatever, and some software to make sound effects, like Audition or there's the free one, Audacity on Windows and all that. Oh, that's a troll face. Yeah, definitely. Good advice, Creeper. Okay. All right. So, yeah. All right. Good. We're going to export this. Sheets. HUD. All user slices. Okay. So, that gives us an image now for the teleport cubes. Now, let's give the player the teleport cubes. Songbringer right, zero item, teleport. Port one. There. So now the player should have teleport cubes. And all we really got to do is make the player warp from one area to another. So we're here at this place eating cactuses. Yay. Okay, cool. So we have the cubes. We can equip them. They're not going to be usable because we haven't written anything yet. However, let's just get it so it uses them really quick. So what I'm going to do for this is I'm going to write a transitionary phase, a transition thing called a flux in my game engine. But I'm going to write a flux that makes the player go in this cool warp, like he's actually going to warp into a red color and a blue. Like your red and blue channels shift outwards, almost like you're watching a old VHS tape or something like that. And the player goes and shoots up way like into a beam of light. And the teleport cubes have this awesome energy around them the whole time. And then basically all of what happens there is it runs that flux and then it fades the screen, transitions you to the new area you've teleported to, fades the scene back in, and then does like the reverse animation so you come back in at that point. So that's all there is to it. So the first thing is just to make it so the system runs has a use item phase. So that is the input system. Here's all the functions for using items. So we'll have teleport. Alright, so I'm gonna do this really, I'm gonna hack this in really fast. So if the player, so we'll set like a destination. And if the player is currently we need a separate area for Songbringer. Well, I guess it could be -201 for now. Okay. So if the world get pause. This is a total hack, but anyways, if it's equal to negative 201 for your on Songbringer. Let's check the world pause.z. So we'll put the player right at the very beginning, even. Just total hack. This is not all exact yet. So if the back to Songbringer. If the player is currently in a dungeon, so if the pause.z is greater than zero, then we return. So you can't use teleport cubes. Inside a dungeon. Back to Songbringer. So this is going to be dest equals pause 00 negative 201. All right, now we just got to hook up this method. So use teleport. Oh man, having this this graphics tablet out sometimes gets glitchy. So use item teleport, K item teleport. There, that should be enough. Oh, one thing. We gotta make sure and do a flux transition. So from the current pause. Oh, to the destination. So just that. E.id, flux, and we'll just do a flux slide for now. Even though flux slide is wrong, you know, you don't want to actually slide the screen to this new area or whatever, but we're just going to use flux slide because I know all that does is it clears out the old area, slides in the new one. So that will essentially mechanically work, but it'll visually look weird. Yeah, thank you guys for saying not to use JavaScript, which is not even JavaScript on Unity. Yeah, thanks, Creeper. Thank you. Yes, Game Overseer, believe Serious Creeper. Don't use Unity's JavaScript. It's not actually JavaScript. It'll teach you bad things. And we did have the same conversation. CaviarX, you could use LiveGDX. I've never heard of C4 though. June Dury, the disadvantage of using Unity script? Big one. It's not actually JavaScript. So it's fooling you into bad habits that you think, oh, this is JavaScript, but it's not JavaScript, it's actually Unity script. And so, and secondly, a big, big disadvantage of using Unity script is that it's used nowhere else. Nowhere else in the world will you use Unity script. So why would you go through the process of learning a language that you can only use in one place? Use C#. It's got so many more advantages because C# you can reuse in other projects, other types of game development. And it's a much more, it's a better language overall. Yeah, good. I'm glad you guys are backing me up on this too. Yes, exactly. Yes, JavaScript is. It's a great language for its purposes, but Unity isn't actually JavaScript. So All right, so let's see if the tele we should not be able to use the teleport cubes here. All right, so good. We're not be able to use them there. Let's see, we should go down here. We should be able to use it. Whoa, I got put into the void. That was weird. It did start to transition. Oh, I know what it is. Flux slide requires that it's going to put the player at a different point. So we really want to use more like downstairs. You know, of course, I'm going to need to actually put this into its own flux. So I guess maybe that's the next step, is just put it in its own flux type of environment, or its own flux function. Okay, so we're here. Let's use the teleport cubes. Ha! Oh, it worked. Very cool. Okay, so now if I'm here on Songbringer, I'm somewhere like in the middle or whatever. Oh, it's not going to let me use my teleport cubes in this room. Tries to craft them. But you should not be able to craft that item. That was weird. Okay, but anyways, the concept is starting to work, so that's cool. So, yeah, I'm over my time, and I'm out of energy today, guys. Sorry about that. So I am going to close down the stream here in a sec. Right, yeah, it is. It's the quirkiest language there is. Cool. Good, June Dory. Good choice. Yes, very good choice. Yeah, it's true. Yeah, what is C4? Oh, this is C4? Oh. Wow, check that out. It's cross-platform for PlayStation, Windows, Mac, Linux, and iOS. That's awesome. What is this, though? How do you get it? You can't click on it. But it says it's not available for licensing at this time. What's that mean, man? Yeah, this is a very big important thing you got to learn. If anyone that is learning JavaScript, I recommend this book called JavaScript, The Good Parts. So yeah, if you're a Java developer, this is like your thing. You've got to read this book. This is incredibly important. Like, buy this book right now and read it. It's so important. If you're a JavaScript developer. What's air softening? Yeah, you know what? I do get that question every time, and I did try and answer that in the FAQ. But the thing is, people aren't always going to read the FAQ anyway, and I'm happy to answer these questions, you know. I'm here to make friends. I'm here to build a following for my game, so I don't mind answering the same questions every day. But if you guys start to mind, let me know. And if I'm answering too many questions that I answer all the time, and it's using up your guys' time, just let me know, and I'll start doing something else about it. So. Yeah, right. Oh man. So yeah, for real, guys, I'm gonna get some dinner. And I'll finish these teleport cubes tonight. So I'm pretty stoked about how this whole item crafting guy turned out. He's really, really cool. If I just warp to him. Yeah, I'm really stoked about this guy. I'm gonna take a screenshot before I go. Alright, got a couple screenshots in there. Alright. So yeah, so tomorrow I don't know what I'll be working on tomorrow, but I'll be back tomorrow, same time. So good night, everybody.